Welcome to Second Watch, your direct line to the second mass. I am Wil Wheaton. I am your host. We have just watched the latest episode of Falling Skies, and we finally got to see the end result of what a harness does to a human, and it is disgusting. Tonight, we are talking with actors Maxim, Colin Cunningham, and writer Heather Regnier. So welcome, everybody. Thanks a lot for coming tonight. It's good to see you. So, Heather, Charleston looks the way I sort of hoped against hope it would not look. Why was Charleston chosen to be the sort of like new seat of the future of America?
We wanted a place that wasn't in the East Coast because we wanted to have a journey. We wanted it to be this new unexplored terrain kind of. And it wasn't as populated as some of the cities were, which were hit by the aliens immediately, so.
A lot of the resistance movement seems to kind of track along American Revolution, American Civil War. Did that factor into
it? Yeah, absolutely. It's similar to just the history. You know, we've explored kind of the North and Massachusetts and all that's kind of loaded in that history, and we wanted to kind of continue that towards the south.
By the way, production designers, if you're watching, you do a really good job of making Vancouver look like not Vancouver. Like, you do a really good job of making it look like everywhere else, which is not easy. Colin, Pope has been one of my favorite characters since I first saw him last season.
Thank you.
He is... It'd be so easy for him to be a mustache twirly guy, and he's just not. Like, there's so much depth and complexity to him, and it's so difficult for me as an audience member to know what his motives are.
It's interesting. I think Pope sometimes wonders why he's spending so much time with the second mass, but I've always seen, when I first looked at the part, looked at the script, I didn't want to do him as a mustache twirling kind of guy. If anything, I saw him as an incredibly articulate, intelligent mind who just happened to make a particular choice in terms of a career path. I've often thought that him and Tom Mason perhaps went to elementary school together. And even went to college together, but ended up parting company. But I think the difference between the Pope character and the Mason character is that one has emotional attachments and the other one doesn't. He's much more like Spock, I think, in many ways. It's just, it's logical. This is what needs to be done, and don't let your heart, you know, pollute the mind, you know, so it's cool that way.
Do you as an actor, without revealing it, do you have an idea why he's staying with the second mass?
Yes, but the great thing about Falling Skies, again, the writing, there's an evolution in what's going on with Pope, or at least that's what I begin to pick up, and it's not so... First season, I would have had a different answer for you. Second season, all of a sudden, he is changing. Yeah. Small little changes, but they're significant.
Max, we've seen a lot of changes with Matt this year. Like, I don't really see him a year ago sitting in the back of the bus talking to this girl who I've decided to name Jenny Krusty Face. So, what was it like for you to play all of those scenes with her?
Well, I think my character in the second season is a lot different than in the first season in that I think I've grown a little bit more mature about what my circumstances are, and I know a little bit more about being a soldier. And I think when I'm talking to Jenny, I may be a little like, you know, maybe I can learn something about the Skitters and maybe I can give this info to my dad or something like that. But also there's a little bit of a kid in there still, you know, because I kind of want to be your friend because, you know, I haven't seen many kids. There's not that many kids around anymore.
What's it like to be the youngest kid in a show? I ask from experience because I was that too before you were born.
It's not that different. I think in the season, we all kind of treat each other like adults, especially with the show and what happens in the show.
That seems to be a common theme this season. We've talked about that a lot on Second Watch. We've talked a lot about how the Mason kids have all had to grow up, and especially with Tom being gone for 3 months at the beginning of the year, that it's like everybody moves up a rung. Like, everybody's where they, you know, where their older brother was.
Yeah, we're all adults now.
Yeah, listen, as a parent, don't grow up so fast. Okay. Heather, two harnessed kids they encounter in this episode refer to Skitters as their guardians, mm-hmm. which was really interesting to me because I talked about this last week, I keep seeing skitters interacting with children and they're maternal. Mm-hmm. Like there is love from these horrible creatures. So are the skitters trying to create a new family for themselves? Do they care about the children that they're harnessing?
Yeah, they do. You know, it's as we saw throughout last season, you know, we discovered that the skitters themselves also have harnesses. So the process that the aliens are kind of applying to us where they, you know, rip our children from our family and they harness them and they kind of start this, you know, they're separate and they go and they have their own community. That happened to them, you know, however many years ago. So I think that there's definitely a part of them that, you know, is not so different from humans and misses having a family and they don't have their children, they don't have anything. So I think they feel sympathy for the children who are also harnessed and obviously in a tough situation because they can't liberate them or anything, but it's kind of trying to make the best of the situation that they're both in.
You know, I think in science fiction, especially, really good bad guys could be the good guys if the story was told from a different point of view. It's the thing I've thought about Pope all along. Like, Pope is clearly, as I have said, the hero of his own story, right? So to see the skitters like that, is this a thing that you guys, when you're in the room, are you looking for ways to, like, I guess, humanize them in certain circumstances?
Yeah, how do I say this without giving anything away? There's potential for skitters because they have somewhat human qualities to be more than what we've seen them be already.
Oh,
if that makes sense.
Very interesting.
Which is all I'll say.
All right.
But they're complicated and they're complex and the harness is part of that. It's kind of their mystery is kind of unraveling.
But I think in 209, Jenny finds a jar of Noxzema and it all just goes away. It all goes away.
Well, I'm sure that this
isn't
going.
That's a spoiler.
I'm sure that this isn't going to fuel any speculation on the internet about the nature of the skitters. What is in store for the second mass in Charleston? What are we going to see? Max, you think Matt's going to find friends there? Or is it like, hi, we're the five guys, we're Charleston?
Actually, Tom Mason's wacky uncle dies and he inherits an all-girl basketball team. It's a riot. Great. It'll be the funniest Falling Skies you've ever seen.
Oh, that's fantastic.
And there's a bionic
dog. Episode,
Max dresses up as a girl and he's the star player.
That's right.
Well, listen, on that note, I think it's time to take some questions from the audience. So, hello, audience. Thank you for joining us tonight. Who has a question for our assembled group of luminaries? Yes, you, sir, in the front.
I have a question for Matt. In the series, do you think you should follow your father's footsteps or become your own man?
Well, part of me really looks up to my father in the show because, you know, he's leading the second mass, and I really wanna help out the second mass too because I really care about, you know, getting these aliens off our planet, but also, I don't like how strict he is with how far I'm able to go. Like, he doesn't want me shooting anyone or doing anything crazy.
But so, you've really grown up this year. Like, you've killed a skitter. Mm-hmm. You were skitter bait, and you were. I mean, it was terrifying, but you were successful, right? And Matt's dad, like, seems like he just doesn't want to acknowledge that.
Yeah,
right?
he still wants to think that I'm the innocent little boy who should stay in the corner and write in his journal, you know?
So you feel that that creates some tension?
Yeah, you know? I think beneath some of that, you know, father-son thing, there's kind of like a dad. It's time for me to go out there and start fighting.
So do you think, like, if Matt could be out on patrols regularly, if he had a regular slot on patrols, that he would be like, yeah, let's do that, let's go?
Yeah, like I was very eager in episode 204 to go with the gang that was gonna go and rescue all their
How'd that work out for you?
All the kids. Didn't work out so great.
Not so well. See, listen to your dad.
But.
Do you think that Matt understands the reality of going out and putting himself at risk, or is it still sort of like a video game? Is it sort of unreal? Do you think he gets that?
I think he doesn't get that much. I think he knows it, but when he goes into a mission, he thinks, okay, I'm gonna do this mission and we're gonna come out successful. He doesn't really think about what could happen that would go wrong.
Usually it would be, I think Matt would be asking for the keys to the car, but instead he's asking for the mag to the carbine.
Yeah. You know?
I mean, it's a completely different kind of world we're living in here.
Does Pope have feelings about Tom Mason as a parent?
I don't think he can afford to. If he does, he's certainly not going to show it, and he's not going to let it influence the decisions that, that need to be made. I mean, there was some great stuff between Pope and Matt in the first season, which I thought was great, because it was like the lion and the lamb, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
But I think the neat thing, at least when I was happy to see it. At first I was like, what, really? But you could see, in the first season, you could see a little bit of light in Pope. There was a little bit of light in that heart, whereas second season, no, let's get rid of that. And let's, you know what I mean? We still got a war to fight before we can start getting sentimental with this guy. So I'm happy that they've kept him on the harder side of things.
Heather, so we're going to entice the audience to tune in next week. What are you going to dangle in front of them?
Aliens.
Aliens.
Several aliens.
It all starts coming together.
Yeah.
Right on. Well, guys, we're out of time. So thank you so much for being here this week. Really, really enjoyed it. And thank you, audience. Thank you. Next week, we will be talking to star Noah Wiley, executive producer and writer Rami Abouchon, and producer-writer Mark Verheiden. In the meantime, you can check out more trivia and behind-the-scenes videos from Falling Skies right here on TNTDrama.com. Don't forget to tune into TNT next Sunday at 9 p.m. for an all-new episode of Falling Skies. And then log on to TNTDrama.com for a new episode of Second Watch. Until next week, keep the resistance strong.